5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition. Liftoff.
SpaceX has become synonymous with U.S. space supremacy.
SpaceX is irreplaceable as a national asset.
Right now, SpaceX is just completely dominant, but it's dominant because it's the best.
For years, the U.S. government and SpaceX have had a mutually beneficial relationship.
The government is an extraordinary customer from us, both the Department of Defense as well as NASA. The news these days is we have $22 billion worth of government contracts. We earn that.
Booster ignition and the final liftoff of Discovery.
The government used to have its own space program, its own shuttle programs, but those were retired, and now the government looks to SpaceX for those capabilities. So without SpaceX, the government cannot deliver its critical technologies into orbit.
But a recent public feud between SpaceX founder Elon Musk and President Donald Trump over Trump's Big Beautiful Bill threatened to end this relationship.
Mr. Trump going after the SpaceX CEO's bottom line. The easiest way to save money in our budget is to terminate Elon's governmental subsidies and contracts. In response, Musk threatening to decommission SpaceX's Dragon spacecraft that is used by NASA to ferry astronauts to the space station.
Although Trump and Musk have since backed off these threats, the temporary rift between two of the world's most powerful men begs the question, how did the U.S. become so dependent on SpaceX? And who has more to lose if the relationship sours again?
This tension with SpaceX and its being a monopoly is one of, if not the biggest challenge for the space program today. If we are held over a barrel by not just a company, but an individual who we have no control over, that's what's, I think, concerning.
Elon Musk founded SpaceX in 2002. Using money that he made from the sale of PayPal, Musk and his new company developed their first rocket, the Falcon 1, to challenge existing launch providers.
There were actually a lot of startup aerospace companies looking to take on this market. They recognized we had a monopoly provider called United Launch Alliance. They had merged the Boeing and Lockheed rocket launch capacity to one company, and they were charging the government hundreds of millions of dollars to launch satellites. But wanting to break that paradigm was seen as really important to a number of companies.
In 2003, Musk paraded Falcon 1 around the streets of DC, hoping to attract the attention of government agencies and the multi-million dollar contracts that they offered. It worked. SpaceX was able to secure a few million dollars from the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, or DARPA, and the U.S. Air Force to further develop its rockets. But the company still struggled.
NASA, and specifically the initial commercial cargo contract, is what saved the company when it was on the brink of bankruptcy.
NASA awarded the $1.6 billion contract, known as Commercial Resupply Services, to SpaceX in 2008, just months after the first successful flight of the Falcon 1. The contract called on SpaceX to use its new rocket, the Falcon 9, along with its Dragon capsule to ferry cargo and supplies to the International Space Station over the course of 12 missions. Orbital Sciences was given $1.9 billion for 8 missions to the ISS. Lori Garver is a former deputy administrator at NASA and was instrumental in establishing NASA's commercial space program, which has become the norm.
In 2009, 2010, we started pitching a program to Congress to allow the private sector to bid on launching astronauts to space as well. We were spending $4-5 billion a year on the space shuttle program and not able to do what it was set out to do, which was make space travel routine and lower the cost. And the best ways to do that in this country, in a capitalist society, tend to be private sector driving innovation. So that program eventually caught on.
That program became known as Commercial Crew. In 2014, NASA awarded SpaceX $2.6 billion and Boeing $4.2 billion to develop and operate vehicles to ferry astronauts to and from the ISS.
3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition. Liftoff of the Falcon 9 and Crew Dragon. Go NASA, go SpaceX. Godspeed, Bob and Doug.
In 2020, SpaceX made history. It was the first time that a commercially built and operated spacecraft carried NASA astronauts to the International Space Station. It was also the first time that the U.S. was able to launch NASA astronauts from U.S. soil since the agency retired the space shuttle in 2011. Up until this time, the U.S. was dependent on Russian Soyuz rockets to launch its crew. Meanwhile, Boeing has struggled to compete.
SpaceX came on strong, and I can't say enough about their success being based on their ability to deliver. Their bid is always lower than their competitors, and then they beat their competitors in timeline and ability. The commercial crew program, a case in point, Boeing got almost twice as much money and hasn't been able to successfully launch and return an astronaut crew.
After launching two NASA astronauts to the ISS on its Boeing Starliner capsule in 2024, the company was forced to return the capsule to Earth empty after it suffered mechanical issues. The two astronauts that were supposed to return on Starliner were eventually brought home on a SpaceX Dragon capsule, months later than originally planned. Today, SpaceX dominates large parts of the space market, from launch to satellites. In 2024, SpaceX conducted a record-breaking 134 orbital launches, more than double the amount of launches done by the next most prolific launch provider, the China Aerospace Science and Technology Corporation. These 134 launches accounted for 83% of all the spacecraft launched last year. Furthermore, SpaceX's Starlink satellites made up 65% of all operational satellites in space in 2024. SpaceX's Dragon capsule and Falcon 9 rocket are the primary means by which NASA launches astronauts and supplies to the International Space Station. The company's Starlink satellites have become indispensable for providing internet access to remote areas as well as to U.S. allies during wartime. The company's Starship rocket, though still in testing, is also key to the U.S. plan to return to the moon. Quilty attributes SpaceX's market dominance to several factors.
Number one, they focused on vertical integration, both to control the costs as well as the speed of development and the engineering cycle. Number two was they focused on key technologies to reduce cost, and that was reusability. And the final thing that SpaceX did that differentiates them from every other competitive player is they scaled. And they scaled without knowledge of the demand necessarily being there, building out production capacity for flat panel antennas, for example, on the Starlink business, where they're producing millions of antennas, whereas previously, you might see global production of less than 100,000 units.
SpaceX is often also credited with considerably bringing down launch costs and undercutting the competition. And this is not even considering the company's latest rocket, Starship. Designed to be the largest and most powerful rocket in the world and built to be fully reusable, SpaceX has said that Starship will reduce launch costs even further, though the rocket is still in testing. Meanwhile, the reliability of the company's Falcon 9 launch vehicles have caused even some of SpaceX's competitors, including Amazon and OneWeb, to launch their satellites on SpaceX rockets.
The ecosystem of space is changed by SpaceX. The lower cost of access to space is doing what we had dreamed of. It is built up a whole community of companies around the world that now have access to space.
Its launch and satellite business has paid off big time for the company. In June, Musk said that SpaceX would bring in $15.5 billion of revenue in 2025 and is on track to exceed NASA's entire budget next year. But lately, SpaceX has also been nudging into a different market, defense.
The DoD is actually a much newer customer for SpaceX, primarily on the Starlink service.
In 2022, SpaceX took in less than $200 million in revenue from the Department of Defense. That's increased significantly.
That ballooned recently to about $3 billion projected in 2025, comprised of a large NRO contract worth $1.8 billion and the company's extensive Starlink and Starshield services used in support of the DoD and specifically Ukraine.
SpaceX's growing role in the defense space has raised some questions around over-reliance on a single private company and whether that company's interests align with the interests of the nation.
A perfect example of this is in Ukraine, where Ukraine relied on Starlink for its services, but Elon Musk refused to provide Starlink services for a Ukrainian military operation because he did not want to start World War III, and he believed that Starlink services would be complicit in that case, so Ukraine could not complete this operation.
As a result, the U.S. government commissioned Starshield, The $1.8 billion contract requires SpaceX to build a network of spy satellites that offer additional security and encryption for military use, and notably are owned and controlled by the U.S. government. Experts say that SpaceX's market dominance has put the U.S. in a tough spot.
The space industry is sort of in the 1913 moment where Ford has figured out how to run a production line and all their competitors are building cars by hand. And although it may be in the government's immediate best interest to give all available contracts to Ford, you would essentially kill the industry and the potential for competition if those contracts are not spread around. And that's the challenge that the government is facing.
But Garber says this isn't a new challenge.
NASA's reliance on SpaceX, it is a symbiotic relationship. That is very similar to NASA's relationship with major contractors throughout its 60-year history, starting with the Rockwells and Northrops for Apollo. But SpaceX is delivering better than anyone else. And so I don't think that the answer is to stop doing things in this way. It's to help level the playing field through investment in technologies and policies that will incentivize others.
One thing that is different about SpaceX, though, is that it's a private company.
Not only is governance different, you have individuals who can make decisions, and you don't have shareholders, and you don't have the transparency required by the SEC for the kinds of things that we've grown to expect, certainly in aerospace programs until now.
The government has been trying to diversify beyond SpaceX. The U.S. Space Force has inked contracts with Rocket Lab, Stoke Space, Blue Origin, and United Launch Alliance, in addition to SpaceX, for launch capabilities. Meanwhile, NASA has contracts with a number of different companies for its Artemis mission, designed to return astronauts back to the moon. NASA declined to be interviewed for this story, but in a statement to CNBC, a NASA spokesperson said, "NASA supports a growing commercial launch services market, space communications, and navigation capabilities, and is working with commercial industry for Artemis missions on the moon. The agency is contributing to a competitive market that will increase commercial innovation and drive down costs as the agency builds economic opportunities in low Earth orbit and around the moon, as we prepare for human exploration of Mars." SpaceX did not respond to CNBC's request for an interview for this story. Still, experts say that SpaceX will continue to dominate the space market for the foreseeable future.
For the next 10 to 15, maybe 20 years, I do not think it's possible for the U.S. to wean itself off of SpaceX, mainly because it takes about 15 to 20 years for a launch company to go from startup to market performer. Of course, there are other competitors that exist, but SpaceX does something unique, and they continue to innovate, and they continue to push forwards in ways that I think will keep them ahead of the curve.